Hello. I'm talking today about the importance of secondary data. I've already spoken on this channel about using documents as data, and documents are a popular form of secondary data, but there are many more options within secondary data beyond documents. Secondary data can be purely quantitative. There's a lot of open data now available online, and much of that is quantitative statistics, health statistics, government statistics, transport statistics, and so on. And these can be really, really useful for researchers. And of course, secondary data can also be qualitative, as with documents, or data kept in repositories. Qualitative data is now kept in repositories all over the world, so researchers may deposit their interview data for other people to reuse, and so on. And of course, you can do multimodal research with secondary data using both quantitative and qualitative data and different methods of collection, analysis, and so on. There are three real types of secondary data in one sense. I'm sure there are lots of ways to categorize it, but this is the way that I tend to think of it. There's data that's been created by research projects which goes on to become data for another research project. These data might be research outputs. So for example, there are a number of videos here on YouTube from a small northern Canadian community called Rigolet. Actually, I think it's in Alaska. No, Labrador, sorry, Labrador. And a big piece of research was done there around the community's response and reaction to climate change. There are videos about that on YouTube, which are now available for use as data by other researchers. They weren't posted here specifically for that purpose, but they are available because they are on this platform. Then there's secondary data, which is specifically created for your own research project. So you might look for baseline data, you might set up systems to produce monitoring data, and so on. And then there is secondary data which has nothing to do with research in terms of its creation. This could include things like newspapers and magazines and the reports and the write-ups in those publications that can be used as data by media and other researchers. There is an awful lot of secondary data available online. I've mentioned open data. Many countries now have open data policies, and health authorities put more data online, governments put more data online, local authorities put more data online, and so on. And there are repositories. I've mentioned qualitative repositories, but there are also quantitative repositories, institutional repositories, mixed repositories. Every university now, I think, has a data repository where you can find data to reuse if you have access. Some have specific access requirements, but some are openly accessible or accessible to certain categories of people. And then there's hard copy data, which you can find in archives, national archives, national libraries, institutional archives. They can be harder to access, but they are there and it is possible if you get permission. And there's unusual data. We sometimes limit ourselves, I think, as researchers in what we view as data, because we think, well, documents and statistics and maybe reports, or maybe videos. But there's also things like leaflets or graffiti. There's all sorts of things, tattoos, that you could regard as research data if you wanted to do that. And there are some good ethical reasons for using secondary data. In general, using secondary data reduces the burden on research participants, and some people are saying now that all researchers really should try to answer their questions first using secondary data and only then go on to collect primary data if they find they can't answer their research questions with the secondary data that exists in the world, because there's so much, it's so varied, we can do more with it than we think. And then reusing data that's already been created for research honours the contribution that was made by those research participants. As long as the proper consents are in place, as long as they have consented to the reuse of that data, then it gives their contribution more weight, more value, because their data has been so thoroughly used. What is not ethical is collecting primary data and then not using that data or not using it fully. And unfortunately, that does happen. It happens a lot still. But it's good to try to work against that by using secondary data and by reusing existing research data where that is possible and available. So if this interests you, if this appeals to you for your research, I'd like to recommend a recent book that's come out. It's actually an edited collection, and it's very helpful, very useful on using, collecting and analysing, despite its title, secondary data. So I'll put the details in with this video, and I wish you luck with your secondary data projects.